The Lord be with you.
Also with you.
A couple announcements to make before we get started. Don't forget that this is VBS week. Be sure and stop by and just see this place full of kids. It's pretty amazing and exciting. There's a VBS staff meeting, if you're on part of the staff part, 12:15 today, and then they're going to spend the whole afternoon, maybe into the evening, decorating and turning this place into a Jerusalem marketplace. So if you want to drop by this afternoon, they may be glad to have your help. Also, next Sunday is 4th of July weekend, and we'll have just one service here in the fellowship hall, and it will be followed by a lunch with, I'm going to make pulled pork and coleslaw, and church is supplying drinks and desserts. And if you'd like, you're invited to bring a side dish to share too, but you don't have to. If you'd like to, that'll be fine. And it'll be a 10:30 time in here, different time, 10:30, and then after that we'll either reset the room depending on how hot it is outside, or we'll move outside under the tents for lunch. But it's a good time to get to see people you don't get to see if you don't go to all the different services too. So I think that's about all, unless anybody else has got anything I need to announce. Oh, yeah, if you had something stored down in the basement, scary basement, they took all that out and cleaned it out and disinfected everything, and it's on the patio, and the big dumpster is probably still out there, I think. Some of it's not really cleanable, so unless you think you want it really bad and you can clean it up and use it, grab it quick, because otherwise it's all going to the dumpster. We're going to start over. So a lot of it was very old, hasn't been used in years. Nobody even knew some of the stuff, what it was even for. So they're going to clean that out next week or so. So if you get a chance to stop over, you know, by the patio where the barbecue is, and see if anything over there is yours to claim. It would be a nice time to do it. Okay, anything else? Yeah, some of the stuff that was in good, better condition they put in there. Some of it they were going to use for VBS, I think. Some of it, I think, it just got put in there. So that's going to need to get cleaned out next. Yeah, find room. We just a little lack of storage space. Yeah, we don't break any hearts. We're gonna make hearts happy. Peace Lutheran Church. And today, Paul talks to the Galatians Christians, new Christians. About some struggles they're having with their church. And, you know, we have our own drought going on here in California. There's kind of a spiritual drought. They were confused about where to go, what they do. They'd heard Paul talk about their new gospel freedom, but they weren't sure how to use it. Some people, it sounded, whoa, freedom, free for everything? This is great. I can sin all I want. Other people go, I'm not sure that's the way it works. So we'll look at what Paul says about that in one of his letters in the New Testament today. So God bless our time as we do that. Why don't we stand for our opening song as we begin in the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. God bless our worship time.
I'm
For freedom, Christ has set us free. Stand firm, therefore, and do not submit again to the yoke of slavery. Follow Jesus and walk by the Spirit. Jesus says, follow me. Often we are not quick to follow, or we choose to go our own way. Jesus looks at a lost world in need of witnesses and says, follow me. Jesus knows the temptations and the decisions we face, and he says, follow me. We falter on the way, we follow the ways of this world, and we fail to keep God's law and make ourselves slaves to sin. Let us pray and silently confess our sins to God. Lord God, you have called us to follow your only begotten Son, to learn from him, to live and grow in him, to tell others of him, and to be faithful to him. We sin against you and one another in thought, word, and deed. We have become enslaved to those things around us and have failed to live in the freedom you have won for us. For the sake of Jesus Christ, forgive us and grant us the clear vision of following him through all the confusion of this world. Then bring us by faith to the presence of everlasting life in your presence. Amen. Jesus says, follow me, and we follow him as forgiven people with grace to do his will. For freedom, Christ has set us free. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. By your faith in Jesus' perfect life, atoning death, and glorious resurrection for you, all your sins have been forgiven. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. May he who began this good work in you bring it to completion in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. You may be seated as we listen to God's word for this morning.
It's from 1 Kings, the 19th chapter. Behold, the word of the Lord came to Elijah, and he said to him, what are you doing here, Elijah? He said, I have been very jealous for the Lord, the God of hosts, for the people of Israel have forsaken your covenant, thrown down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword, and I only am left, and they seek my life to take it away. And he said, go out and stand on the mount before the Lord. And behold, the Lord passed by, and a great and strong wind tore the mountains and broke in pieces the rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, the sound of a low whisper. And when Elijah heard it, he wrapped his face in his cloak and went out and stood at the entrance of the cave. And behold, there came a voice to him and said, what are you doing here, Elijah? He said, I have been very jealous for the Lord, the God of hosts. For the people of Israel have forsaken your covenant, thrown down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword, and I only am left, and they seek my life to take it away. And the Lord said to him, go, return on your way to the wilderness of Damascus, and when you arrive, you shall anoint Hazael to be king over Syria, and Jehu the son of Nimshi you shall anoint to be king over Israel, and Elisha the son of Shaphat of Abel-Meholah you shall anoint to be prophet in your place. And the one who escapes from the sword of Hazael shall Jehu put to death, and the one who escapes from the sword of Jehu shall Elisha put to death. Yet I will leave 7,000 in Israel, all the knees that have not bowed to Baal, and every mouth that has not kissed him. So he departed from there and found Elisha the son of Shaphat, who was plowing with 12 yoke of oxen in front of him, and he was with the 12th. Elijah passed by him and cast his cloak upon him. And he left the oxen and ran after Elijah and said, let me kiss my father and mother, and then I will follow you. And he said to him, go back again, for what have I done to you? and he returned from following him and took the yoke of oxen and sacrificed them and boiled their flesh with the yokes of the oxen and gave it to the people, and they ate. Then he arose and went after Elijah and assisted him. This is the word of the Lord. The epistle reading is from Galatians, the 5th chapter. For freedom Christ has set us free. Stand firm, therefore, and do not submit again to a yoke of slavery. For you were called to freedom, brothers, only do not use your freedom as an opportunity for the flesh, but through love serve one another. For the whole law is fulfilled in one word, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. But if you bite and devour one another, watch out that you are not consumed by one another. But I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the desires of the flesh are against the Spirit, and the desires of the Spirit are against the flesh. For these are opposed to each other, to keep you from doing things you want to do. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. Now the works of the flesh are evident: sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, fits of anger, rivalry, dissensions, divisions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and things like these. I warned you, as I warned you before, that those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. And those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. If we live by the Spirit, let us also keep in step with the Spirit. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you.
Please rise for a gospel reading. The Holy Gospel today comes to us from the Gospel of St. Luke, chapter 9, beginning at verse 51. When the days drew near for Jesus to be taken up, he set his face to go to Jerusalem, and he sent messengers ahead of him who went and entered the village of the Samaritans to make preparations for him. But the people did not receive him because his face was set toward Jerusalem. And when his disciples James and John saw it, they said, "Lord, do you want us to tell fire to come down from heaven and consume them?" But he turned and rebuked them, and they went on to another village. As they were going along the road, someone said to him, "I will follow you wherever you go." And Jesus said to him, "Foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head." To another he said, "Follow me." But he said, "Lord, let me first go and bury my father." And Jesus said to him, "Leave the dead to bury their own dead. But as for you, go and proclaim the kingdom of God." Yet another said, "I will follow you, Lord, but let me first say farewell to those at my home." But Jesus said to him, "No one who puts his hand to the plow and looks back is fit for the kingdom of God." This is the gospel of the Lord. Please be seated.
Imagine the amount of confidence it takes for that, right? To just drop everything and follow him. Join with us in this next one.
Like a face, my child.
Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. So did our ongoing drought affect your vegetable garden plans this year? That one day a week watering has to make it tough. You know, there are some drought-resistant veggies you can try if you want to, if you've been holding off. Lima beans, for one, although I can't remember the last time I had one, unless one of you snuck it into your three-bean salad at a potluck. Actually, I found a special variety of tomatoes and even a watermelon that can do well with a minimum of water. Summer squash, pole beans, and corn are supposed to be drought tolerant, but whether or not you can start them in a drought is a question for our resident specialist. I sat in on a Camarosa Water District town hall last week where they explained the situation in a very straightforward way, and people got to ask all their questions. It was very well handled, but not really very hopeful for the near term. Adequate infrastructure and new reservoirs have been put on the back burner in this state for decades. You know, I guess I've been living in a bubble, but I had no idea that 50% of California's water is allotted to environmental issues, things like the Delta smelt and wetlands. 40% goes to agriculture, and farmers deserve every drop they can get. And the 10% that's left, that's for you and I to use. That's what we have to live on. You can scratch your head all you want wondering how, about the logic of that, but you don't have to be a rocket scientist to sense that something is skewed here. The details get complicated and political, but the bottom line is that it all seems to be a top-down issue. As Christians in ministry, we're in the middle of another drought that's going to be just as hard to solve, but this one won't require a ballot measure because we're already on the same page. I'm talking about the spiritual drought we've been seeing in our own local congregations. It was in the news again last week when a Gallup poll found that Americans' belief in God has dipped to the lowest level since they started polling that question back in 1944. Faith in God hung in there over 90% for most of that time, all the time since, really, until 2016. And that year it dipped to 89% and then 87%. And now in 2022, just 81% of Americans say they believe in God. The group least likely to believe? Younger, liberal Americans. The ones we already know are probably the least likely to see in church on Sunday. Along with the shrinking of God believers, the number of nuns has been steadily growing. No, not those nuns. Not the nuns in the habit. No, these nuns have gotten out of the habit of attending church and professing the faith that they may have been raised in when they were young. These are the people who answer none when questioned about what religion they're affiliated with. The Pew Research study last December found that 3 out of 10 U.S. adults are now religiously unaffiliated. 3 out of 10, 30%. And the number is climbing. The majority of the nuns say they simply don't believe anymore, that they've become disenchanted with religion. It's an odd word to use with religion, right? Disenchanted, like you're enchanted in some magical way by it. It's not magic at all. Some say they're just anti-institutional church, and maybe you've heard that. I sure have. Others say they're unaffiliated but still religious, and still others say they're spiritual but not religious. A lot of them were led away from faith during their college years. Others were influenced by watching too many Christians doing unchristian things. Where do you begin to sort all that out? Well, we need help. God can send the rain to help us with our climate drought, but he won't fix our lack of planning for it. And he's already sent his spirit to help us in our times of spiritual drought. We just have to remember how to tap into it. Paul's writing to first century believers who are struggling with their new Christian faith this morning. And there are lessons there for us. You know, being part of a faith community, that should be an exciting time. It should get you all fired up. Learning about all the gifts of the Spirit we've been given and watching them manifest themselves in us so that, you know, we won't be the people that other people use as an excuse to separate themselves from the faith. We plant a garden these days and then we have to pray for a speedy crop to appear, at least before the neighbors catch us out there at midnight with a hose, right, trying to turn dry, cracked soil into something a little more seed-friendly. We often wish that the fruits of the Spirit would appear instantaneously in our lives, making us more loving and joyful or generous people. But just like a quality fruit or vegetable, it all takes time and hard work. The potential is there in the seed that was planted even before the baptismal water dried. But maturing into the whole package that God wants us to be, that he intends for us with deep roots, that takes time. We receive the Spirit's gifts as a potential, very real in God's free gift. But even the Spirit's fruit can have a hard time surviving in a hostile environment. You know, like a drought of irregular worship attendance or lack of Bible study or service in God's kingdom. Unconnected, disconnected, we can lose that tug of war we're in. You know, as we've worked our way through Galatians over the past few weeks, we've been talking about Paul's assurance that the law has no claim on believers. It used to be a master accuser, but no longer. Jesus fulfilled the law for us. And for the Galatians who were experiencing the freedom from that burden, it was for the very first time. Now, the Jews had been freed from their law. The Gentiles had been freed from their idols and were actually being welcomed into this new Christian church. And they were all struggling with the implications of exactly what that meant in their lives. Their failure to grasp the concept of this new freedom of the gospel warranted a series of letters from Paul to the churches. That's what makes up a good part of our New Testament, the Bible. You were called to freedom, brothers, he writes, only do not use your freedom as an opportunity for the flesh. And he's addressing real life, real time issues that reach across time to us. As he put it in Romans 6, he says, we're not free to sin, but we've been freed from sin. But we're still not free to cross certain boundaries. We're not free to abuse the moral code, for example, the Ten Commandments. We're not free to engage in what the Bible calls carnality, indulging in the pleasures of the flesh just for the sake of indulging. And that's what was happening. Some people interpreted this gospel freedom to mean they'd just been given a free pass to do whatever they pleased. The morality and flawed thinking of those ancient societies really wasn't all that different from our society today. So if the law no longer drives believers to right or wrong through its accusing power, what does? Well, since coming to faith, we're guided by something better, something more. Now we're held and driven by love. Paul says, the whole law is fulfilled in one word, love. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. Now, the liberty we enjoy as Christians isn't a liberty to sin all the more. Now we live for love, to reach out in love, to serve others in love, to serve God in love, even when it's not convenient. See, love finds a way. Our hearts, indwelled with God's Holy Spirit, have become the base of operation from which we reach out and serve others. Through love, Paul says, serve one another. The word he uses for serve means to serve as a slave. The slaves serve other people. That's Paul's summary of the Christian life. You know, we have been called to serve, saved to serve. And Jesus himself set the tone when he said, follow me. Remember, the Galatians were torn between Paul's gospel and one that a group called the Judaizers were bringing with them. They claimed that Paul's gospel fell short. If you wanted to really be saved, believers in Jesus still had to keep all those minutiae of the Old Testament law, the rites and the rituals and things. And you have to admit, having something to do besides just believing that Jesus did it all for us does appeal to our reason. Our reason's as fallen as the rest of us. Right or wrong, just like it appealed to theirs. It made sense. It was wrong, but it made sense. You can't help but appreciate Paul's skills, how he attacks it. He recognizes where they're coming from, and that's where he starts. He's saying, okay, you want to keep the law? Keep it. But know this, the law can be reduced to just one word, love. Even more, love your neighbor as yourself. You know where that first comes from in the Bible? Well, the preschool answer is Jesus, right? And that's true. Jesus says it more than once. But it first shows up in the Old Testament book of the law called Leviticus. It's right in between all these little rules and regulations and section on sexual immorality even. And all of a sudden, there it is. You know, love your neighbor as yourself. As long as you love your neighbor as yourself, there's no need for a whole legalistic list of rules and regulations, is there? Love won't commit murder. Love won't commit adultery. Love won't steal. Love won't cheat or lie or even covet what someone else has. In fact, love will convert the law's negatives to life's positives. See, while love won't murder, it will pick up a stranger lying along the side of the road who's been beaten and robbed and left for dead. Love will carry that person to a place where they can receive first aid and food and shelter. And love will pay for any expenses incurred in their care, and it will return to pay for any additional expenses in the future. That's Jesus' parable of the Good Samaritan. You know, love will look out for a neighbor and help him protect his family and keep what he owns without expecting anything in return. Love will anticipate a poor man's needs, and it will be swift to speak well of others, always looking for positives. You know, Paul's saying, who needs the law when there's love? You know, love your neighbor. That's all the law you'll ever need. You know, you'll still have arguments. You'll still have disagreements. You're not perfect. Just watch out that when those things happen, you don't consume one another. He says to these new Christians, and of course to us, walk by the Spirit. You know, those seeds to keep the law of love were planted in some pretty hostile territory, soil where tempers get too hot, where our concern for the good of others is often too cold, where the nutrients needed to enrich that soil are about as plentiful as water is in the desert, or my backyard. But Paul isn't going to ask something of us that's impossible. He says, walk by the Spirit. In other words, be like Jesus. And he knows that God has made it possible for redeemed sinners like us to be like Jesus. Not perfectly, of course, but in practice, we can certainly be better than the sinful people we were born. A person ruled by a sinful nature has no hope of redemption. There's not a thing he or she can do to redeem themselves. Any attempt to please God by keeping his law is bound to fail because, you know, we can never be good enough or do enough to please a holy, perfect God. The good news is that God made man with a God-shaped space, and our hearts are to be the home of his Holy Spirit. And if we'll just put our own thoughts and desires about how we think things ought to be aside for a minute, if we allow the Spirit to do his work in us, we'll begin to radiate God. We'll become a living package so filled with goodness and fruit that we'll attract others to God. And people will no longer see the things that come naturally, you know, at least not as often. And Paul lists some of them. You know, some of our most familiar companions, maybe. Things like immorality, and idolatry, enmity, strife, jealousy, fits of anger, rivalries, envy, dissensions and divisions. These things will be replaced by the things that of God that don't come naturally, like new friends or new acquaintances, better companions. Will be reshaped by God, molded into people who much more resemble Christ. Our fruit will look like the fruit of the Spirit. You know, love, joy, peace, patience and kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. The fruits of the law, really, when they're boiled down to their essence, which is love. But it's not easy, though. It's not natural. It's hard work. There's a constant battle going on for the control of your heart, a battle of the flesh against the Spirit. When you were first brought to faith, whether you were born again at the waters of the baptismal font or at the Lord's own table in communion or through hearing or reading his word, a miracle occurred. More than one miracle, really. The old man within us, sometimes called the old Adam in the Bible, was sort of pushed off his throne in your heart and drowned. The old man who could do nothing right. The old nature that never wanted to. His rule was replaced by Christ's rule through the Spirit. And along with your new life, you were given a new attitude. The hot, dry, inhospitable soil became fresh, moist, fertile ground. The kind of ground that welcomed new life and the kind of ground in which the Spirit's seeds could grow and prosper. And I wish I could tell you that you lived happily forever after that, but we both know it's not the end of the story. The battle goes on every day and every night. We know that the story will eventually reach, you know, the greatest happy ever after ending of any book ever written, because along with your new birth, you received the promise of a new home with a heavenly Father whose unconditional love will sustain you until the day you're freed from this sinful, fallen world. The war was won in Calvary. The old nature refuses to take the news lying down. See, coming to faith is the beginning of a lifelong battle in which you'll win some skirmishes and you'll lose some skirmishes. And on those days when you feel like you fought hard and you still lost, remember your baptism. Remember who you really are, a child of the one true God. And remember whose you are, son or daughter of the King who will always forgive a repentant heart for Jesus' sake and strengthen your resolve to get out and fight the battle another day. And in another day, and another day, until the day comes when we never have to face another battle again, because free from these sinful bodies and freed from this sinful fallen world, we can finally be all God created us to be in Christ Jesus. The day we'll see him face to face. Now, Paul finishes this morning, if we live by the Spirit, let us also walk by the Spirit. That's not Paul's way to ask us the impossible. He's not trying to set us up for failure here. Even Jesus says, follow me. And so we have a choice. Every single day, we can choose to follow Jesus, led and empowered and enabled by the Spirit, or we can follow the shadow of the law. We can follow our dark side, the old man within us who didn't say drowned at all, but revived for return engagement. In his love for us, God also gave us a free will. We can choose who we'll follow. And if we refuse to allow the old flesh to indulge its sinful side, the new man will embrace our religious side. And that'll get us up and out of bed and to church every Sunday morning. It'll sing in the choir. It'll teach a Sunday school class. It'll get involved on a committee or in congregational leadership or volunteer at Vacation Bible School. It will rejoice in the gifts of the Spirit and visit shut-ins and be an encourager and a prayer warrior, and it will follow Jesus. It will reflect on the outside that gratitude for salvation that burns so brightly on the inside. And people will see some of Christ in you and be drawn to that light. It's a lot easier than growing juicy, fresh vegetables without water. And it may not be the wide road that most of the world is following, but it's the one that will get you home at last. So who needs the law when there's love? Amen. And now may that very special peace of God that passes all understanding keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. We'll take a moment now to receive your gifts, your tithes, and your offerings as we prepare for communion. Okay, let's take a moment now to confess our Christian faith together. We'll do it this morning in the words of the Nicene Creed. Please rise as we confess our Christian faith together. Please join with me. This is the faith by which we're saved. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible, and in one Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshiped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins. And I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us pray. Blessed are you, Lord of heaven and earth, for you have had mercy on those whom you created, and sent your only begotten Son into our flesh to bear our sins and be our Savior. With repentant joy, we receive the salvation accomplished for us by the all-availing sacrifice of his body and blood on the cross. Gather the name and remembrance of Jesus, we beg you, O Lord, to forgive, renew, and strengthen us with your word and spirit. Gather us together, we pray, from the ends of the earth, to celebrate with all the faithful the marriage feast of the Lamb and his kingdom, which has no end. Graciously receive our prayers, deliver and preserve us. To you alone, O Father, be all glory, honor, and worship, with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God now and forever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the same night on which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." The same way also he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always. You may be seated and come forward at the direction of the ushers. Now may this body and blood of our Lord strengthen and preserve you steadfast in true faith unto life everlasting. Go in God's peace and God's joy. Your sins have been forgiven. Amen. Please rise for prayer. Let us pray now for the whole church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. God of our salvation, when your Son set his face to go to Jerusalem on the cross, his zeal would not be deterred. Grant us to pray with the same fervor and boldness, trusting that you hear us for the sake of the Son of Man. Lord, in your mercy. God of compassion, you established the family to be a place of protection and growth. Grant that our homes would never become a stumbling block to the kingdom of God, but that they would serve to foster within us the fruit of the Spirit. Lord, in your mercy. God of all power and might, to you belong the kingdom and the glory forever. Give insight and wisdom to our president, governor, legislature, and magistrates. Direct them to punish evildoers. Reward the righteous and strive for peace. Grant that Christians may live quiet and peaceable lives. Lord, in your mercy. God of refuge, your salvation draws near to all who trust in you. Grant peace to your people and show us your salvation. Hear our petitions for healing, strength, and comfort. Be the refuge of the weary and the God who preserves his people. Lord, in your mercy. God of our Lord Jesus Christ, grant that the whole church might fix her eyes on him. Teach us the way of the cross. Remove hindrances and distractions. Do not let the freedom we have in the gospel become an excuse for sin and vice, but an opportunity for love and service. Lord, in your mercy. In your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his very, very special peace. Amen.
till you've bowed my Jesus, oh.
Great day, everybody. Jesus bless your week.